Good morning, everyone. Welcome to the 19th meeting of the Net Zero Energy and Transport Committee for 2022, which is taking place in hybrid format today. Today we have apologies from Fiona Hislop, and Colette Stevenson joins the committee as a substitute. Good morning. Welcome back, Colette. At agenda item 1, we have consideration of whether to take items 3, 4 and 5 in private. Item 3 is consideration of the committee's annual report. Item 4 is consideration of the evidence heard today. And item 5 is consideration of our approach in relation to an inquiry into ferry services. Do we agree to take these items in private? Thank you very much. That is agreed. Items 3, 4 and 5 will be taken in private. Our next item is an evidence session in relation to our ongoing inquiry into the role of local government and its cross-sectoral partners in financing and delivering a Net Zero Scotland. Today we are delighted to have a representative of the city of Freiburg in Germany's Black Forest, a city well known for its net zero policies. We're going to use this short session to explore what experience local authorities in Scotland can gain from the city of Freiburg in relation to their responsibilities in delivering net zero. This morning I'm delighted to welcome Franziska Breyer, Executive Manager of Climate Neutrality Staff Unit, Environmental Protection Office, Green City Freiburg. Good morning, Ms. Breyer. Thank you very much for joining us. It's a pleasure to have you in front of this committee of the Scottish Parliament. We've allocated around 45 minutes for this session, and I believe you would like to start with a brief opening statement. If that is correct, I will hand over to you. Thank you.
Yes, thank you very much. Am I online? Can you hear me?
Yes, we can hear you. Thank you.
Yeah. Okay. Thank you very much for the occasion to tell something about our experience in Freiburg with sustainable development and climate protection. I'm a forester by profession. I work with the State Forest Administration, but now I work quite a bit in the city administration for about 30 years in different functions. Now I'm in charge of the staff unit climate neutrality, because although Freiburg is committed for a very long time already to sustainability and climate protection, we realize that we have to move on faster and be more radical, more efficient in this field of action. And I hope I can answer all your questions, and I will take notes if I cannot, and I'm very curious. I have been to Edinburgh. My daughter worked there for half a year once, and I like the city very much, and I think exchanging experience, exchanging information that moves the world, especially the local level, to my opinion, is very important to achieve net zero and climate neutrality. Without the cities and local authorities, it won't work. So I hope I can contribute something to your level of information. I will try to do my best.
Excellent. Thank you very much indeed. I completely agree. The exchanging good ideas. This is, after all, a global challenge we all face. So exchanging ideas is a very good thing to do. So once again, thank you very much for being with the committee this morning. The first question I have is a common challenge we face in Scotland, and I believe in your area as well. That is the challenge of retrofitting houses to make the fabric of homes more insulated, combined with the decarbonisation of heating. I wonder if you could talk us through the different measures taken in Freiburg in the area of energy efficiency and heat decarbonisation, and what role has the private sector played in this delivery of the decarbonisation of heat?
Yes. Well, there are two parts of your question. The one is how much energy do buildings and houses consume, and how do we provide this energy? And the first has a longer history in Freiburg. Already at the beginning of the 90s, we've defined a building standard for new houses in Freiburg being built. Although, apart from this, we have to say the building stock is also a big challenge. But building new houses, it's easier naturally to achieve a high standard. And we had the ambition to be a little bit ahead of the state law and the federal regulations for housing. So low energy housing has a tradition of 30 years already in Freiburg. And if the state law and the federal law doesn't allow us to define a too high standard, we put it in the contracts. If we sell land for investors to build houses, we put it in the private land contract if the law doesn't allow us to define a very high standard. So we define our own standard and try to regulate this via the land contract for housing. So if we have new areas of the city where building takes place, we try to define the standard as high as possible, knowing that it's very the real estate market is really on top in Freiburg. It's very, very pricey, very costly to live here. And the real estate business really makes revenue. So I think they can afford a high energy standard. And this also means lower costs for heating, actually, for the people. But we realize that building new houses, it's easy to have a very high standard, but the building stock, how to refurbish, how to retrofit the housing stock is really a challenge. So we have, in addition to the subsidy programs we have from the state level or the federal level, we have a local subsidy program for Freiburg, for our citizens and house owners, where they can get subsidies if they want to have an insulation of the roof or new windows or even solar panels now. So we try to have a mixed strategy. We define high standards for new buildings. For the existing buildings, we cannot define standards, so we try to have a pull strategy. In addition to the regulations on the state and federal level, we try to have our local standards. And the other thing is that now we also have to, it's not only enough to get the energy demand down, but we have to think of where comes the heating demand from. And in former times, we used to have several sectors in the energy field, like mobility, industry, private households, enterprises. But now we have this, the coupling of sectors. That means we have the technology at hand to get everything from renewable electricity, which means that electricity, renewable power, has really gained in importance. So we have a so-called master plan heat for the whole city, worked out with the expertise from engineers, different engineers, and we try to divide the city in certain areas. The central area where the housing is very dense, we put a focus on district heating, which must be decarbonized in the long run. And in the outskirts of the city where the building is not so densely, we put a focus on heat pumps. So that means first get the heating demand down as much as you can, as much as law allows you. And secondly, try to substitute the fossil energy, which is also in Freiburg still in the system. We have still lots of natural gas in the system with heat pumps in the areas where the district heating might be too costly because it's a huge investment to put these tubes underground. And in the inner part of the city where it's densely, the building is very dense, the structure, we have district heating systems underground and try to put as much renewable energy into the system as we can. And living in the Upper Rhine Valley, we also have some hope that we will be able to tap geothermal energy because this is an area where it might be valuable. I hope this could answer part of the question.
Absolutely. You've answered all of my questions and more. Thank you very much. A very brief follow-up before I move on to another area. First of all, it's interesting that Freiburg is using contractual terms to go beyond existing legislation so that you have more freedom to increase standards. But my question relates to the source of heat, the decarbonized heat. It sounds like district heating is being used in urban areas and heat pumps are used in more rural areas where the density is lower. That's a very interesting observation. I wonder if you could talk us through, I guess, the engineering rationale or the technical reasons for this being the case?
Yes, this is not already the state of the art. This is the goal. This is our strategy that the Municipal Council has decided on with this master plan heat. So we are going step by step in this direction. But the goal is not to have district heating everywhere because it's costly, and especially the refurbishment going on and new standards going on, the heat. So the return of investment for putting a system of tubes underground, district heating system, will be less and less. So we have to really stick to the areas where we have district heating already and try to connect the grids underground and put a stress on more decentralized approaches like heat pumps, which are fueled with renewables, mostly from solar panels, but also wind energy, or we have also a small amount of hydropower and biomass energy in the system. And we try to have this mixed strategy, and we work hand in hand with our local energy utility so that we have a mixed strategy. We have already a huge heat, district heating system in the inner part of the city. We try to connect the different grids. Sometimes it's difficult because a part of the grid belongs to the university, the clinic of the university, which still use another technology. So combining the grids might be also tricky and a challenge, but we think that it's easier. We hope that we will get geothermal heat into the system, and the rest must come also from big heat pumps or from renewables. And this is quite a challenge because there's still a lot of natural gas in the heating sector.
Okay, yes, very interesting. I have one more question before I bring in other members. What you are discussing requires collaboration between different agencies and institutions, because so many different agencies have different responsibilities. What institutions have, what are the institutions in Freiburg that have been key to the successful delivery of net zero? Is this all about local government, or has there been a close working partnership between local government and you know, federal government?
Yes, this is always nice. You can go a little bit back in time, because the tradition that of that energy issues are so important, and also a public debate about this is really in the 70s. We call it our big bang of our environmental movement, when people from the city and the local the farmers around protested successfully against the nuclear power plant that was supposed to be built close to Freiburg, and they were successfully. And from this success, the public debate is energy is an important issue, and we can have an impact on politics. So we are lucky, and sometimes it's also very exhausting to have a population, the citizens here in this city, that are very interested, very committed to energy issues, and that they said, okay, if we don't want nuclear power, what is it that we want then? In the 80s, it was the resources. Since the 90s, since the Rio conference, it's climate action. That but there's a very sometimes controversial debate between the citizens and the administration. And we have lots of stakeholders that are here in Freiburg, like the Fraunhofer Institute for Solar Energy Systems, also international renowned institutions that can contribute. And no institution here can really survive without being committed to this to these issues, because also in the municipal council, across all the political parties, maybe apart from the AfD that we have unfortunately now, for 2 years, not very environmentally committed party, but all the other parties are, there's always a consensus about climate protection and sustainability, and that makes it easy. But having a population that is very self-confident and very powerful, that also says you must go faster, the budget is not big enough, it also pushes us, it criticizes us, and the media always mirror that. So this is sometimes tiring for an administration, but I think consensus sometimes is overrated. The worst thing for a city is that if the people don't care. So being committed and quarreling with the administration and having controversial debates also sometimes in the public, this is good, because it creates an energy. And from this energy, this transformation process, which is very, very hard, and the administration is not very agile. It's a little bit like this. So we need a population, we need self-confident citizens that say, we put a pressure on you, go ahead. The next election is around the corner, go ahead. And we have this very controversial situation, but I think it's a fruitful situation. And naturally, not only the citizens, but many institutions, the university is a hub of information and also of new development. And we try to get the most out of this situation, which is sometimes controversial, but it's always fruitful, I think.
Yeah, that's fascinating. Thank you very much. I'm sure my colleagues will want to pick up on some of the issues you've raised already. So let me bring in one of my colleagues, Mark Ruskell, who is joining us remotely. Mark, over to you, please.
Thanks very much. Really interesting to hear your evidence this morning, Franziska. And can I just pick up on your last point about how engaged citizens are in Freiburg? Can you talk me through what the formal mechanisms are for engaging citizens? I mean, because there is a danger that with some issues that there can be what we call in English, you know, consultation fatigue, where people just are constantly asked about public policy. But what sort of mechanisms do you have for engaging citizens? Are there citizens' assemblies, or particular referendums or discussions on particular issues? How does it manifest itself?
Yeah, we have a tradition of some instruments, and now at the moment it's really speeding up. So we are now facing a variety of new formats of citizen participation. But what has a strong tradition is that in all the committees of the municipal council, there are always people from institutions and expertise from outside the municipal council that can discuss and contribute, even if the decision is taken in the council later on. So we try to get as much expertise in this process before. And we have also referendums. For instance, very controversial things, which are also from the sustainability point of view controversial. We build a new soccer stadium, and we build plan a whole new city district, because Freiburg is a city that is had a very high life quality, which is famous, popular university city. Many people move here, not only students, young people, but also people who retire. They say, oh, if I'm going to spend the rest of my life, I'd like to be in a nice surroundings. So having a population which is increasing, whereas in eastern parts of Germany, population is decreasing, this uses conflicts, land use conflicts, resources conflicts, and building a totally new city district naturally enlarges our carbon footprint. We use land, we use resources, we will use lots of grey energy. So this was a controversial debate also in the municipal council, and we said this is such an important decision, we ask the whole population, everybody can vote. And only when a rather significant majority said, yeah, this new city district should be built, then we said, okay, we have a climate neutrality concept. This will be a new city district where nothing will be burnt. All the heat and electricity will come from renewables and waste energy from sewage, from wastewater. And and the new soccer stadium, it was the same. It's a climate neutral stadium with lots of panels on the roof, but nevertheless, it's gray energy. It's a space that is used. So also this was such an important decision that it was a referendum with the whole population. And the citizens also, it's not only offered by the administration, but the citizens can claim a referendum. They can say if they get enough votes, I don't know, 2,000 or 5,000, I don't have the exact number. They can also, they have the right to demand a referendum. And now we have, naturally, we have these movements like Extinction Rebellion or Fridays for Future, many citizens group that have a strong impact and build up also their own expertise and ask the administration, why this and not this? Why are you not going fast enough? And we have, especially on the transport mobility sector, we have so it was in German, it was called Mobilitätsentscheid. Citizens really ask the others, and they put a vote on it. So it really moved the administration. So they were working now a climate mobility plan at the moment. And we have two initiatives, one with the bordering counties, how Freiburg and the two bordering counties could get 100% renewables. And this is citizens, representatives from the two counties and the city working together on this plan and confronting the administration afterwards. Mm-hmm. And also, Klima Entscheid, which means it's kind of like a referendum for climate protection. So there is a lot of, it's like a biodiversity of initiatives. But I think we are in such a situation of urgent climate action. I think in Germany, we had the pandemic. Now we have this horrible war in Ukraine. But the elephant in the room is climate action. We cannot put this aside and say we first take the urgent problems and then we take on this problem again. So I think this commitment of the citizens and this pressure being put on the administration mirrors the importance that this issue has for our life, for our future, and also, if you talk about climate justice already, for many countries that aren't as rich as we are and as well off, given the consideration that we have a carbon rucksack historically that is weighs high on our shoulders. So I think it's hard for the administration to handle this, because naturally we have to stick to the law. We have certain mechanisms that must be followed. We have to prove things and counterprove things. We cannot rush in. Sometimes the people say, you are so slow, you are like a snail or a turtle. But I think naturally we are part of the executive. We are part of this system, and we don't have a better system yet. But we can take this energy and try to make something fruitful and maybe really get some more pressure on climate action, because if we don't act fast, much faster than we did even in Freiburg, we will get these turning points and the future will not be funny, not even here in Freiburg. Climate change is happening also here. We had years when our river fell dry already here.
It's great to hear how you're harnessing that energy from the citizens, and something we can certainly learn from here in Scotland, I think. Can I ask you then also about the sustainability goals that you have? I think those have been in place for a long time now. How do those influence policy making? Do you have a kind of sustainability framework that you apply to the policies, or how do they influence the individual discussions that politicians and others are having?
Yeah, we have a staff unit for sustainable development also. It's a sustainability management, and we have our own goals defined and decided on by the Municipal Council in very close to these SDGs, the United Nations, that I think 2015. The problem with the sustainability goals is that we have, I think we are not, it's not a single problem in Freiburg, but all over the place. It's also the problem with the SDGs is that they don't go all in harmony. We have different SDGs, and the very, very tricky thing is that they are not equal. We have something like life conditions, and we have something, we are the ground we walk on, the water we drink, the air we breathe, the temperature we have to deal with. And we have other things that can base on these things. And it's very difficult to tell the people and tell also the different offices in the administration that we have to safeguard our preconditions of life. And then we add on the economy and the social issues and so on. And we don't have yet a mechanism how to deal with conflicts between these SDGs, because it's very easy to define for education, for housing, for water resources, for climate protection, for social justice, for education in general, so that it's not connected with your social background, what job you get. It's very easy to define the goals. What is really difficult is to get a prioritization. And sometimes also working in the climate action sector, we are confronted with the attitude, you think you are you rule the world because you think you are so important, but we are all equal important. And it's very difficult to say, this might be that it's worthwhile putting your brain and your heart and your action into every field of action. But if we destroy the ground we are walking on, our life preconditions, then we can work out cultural concepts, social concepts as much as we want. It won't last. So we have this magic triangle of sustainability, like social issues, economical issues, ecological issues, but it's not equal important. We have to safeguard the preconditions of life here also in Middle Europe. And if we don't do this, the other concepts cannot jump in. And this, so I think this is the problem with sustainability goals, that it's we still lack a mechanism how, in a way that it's accepted by all the stakeholders, prioritize things and say, let's concentrate on safeguarding our life conditions, and then everything is built on that. But if we neglect the ground we are walking on, then all the good concepts won't work. So I think this is also a problem in Freiburg, since if you look in our SDGs, they are all wonderful. Every sustainability goal is wonderful. Tax income, tax revenue for the city, in order we can build kindergartens and repair the streets and the bridges and everything. But where does these taxes come from? How much do we pay in ecological money to get this revenue? All these things are very, very difficult. And they are also difficult here.
Can you give me a specific example of where there's perhaps been conflict between those sustainable development goals and how that was resolved? Was it ultimately for politicians to resolve that, or?
I think it's not really faced by politics here, because also here in Freiburg we tend to be happy with the goals, huh? And the sustainability goals we have, they are out of question. They are good, and it's always worthwhile to try to achieve them. And the politicians also, not only the administration, but also the politicians, they are they have a hard time confronting these goal conflicts, and they have a hard time to say what is more important and more important, because we have lobby groups also here for every field of action, so to say. So I think that it's not really it's not really seen. And we try to stick to the goals, which are good, and say we have all these, like in a catalog, we have all these goals, and it's we put them all together and stir around, and this is sustainability. But this is not how it works, and this is still a task to do also here, to put the priorities right and not having the message that other fields of action are less important or less fascinating or less worthwhile working. But we have to get the priorities clear. But there are not, it's not really a conflict. It's not really on the table. It's rather a little bit in the background.
Okay. Thanks for that. Can I move on to another question? I was interested to hear earlier that you're a forester by background. And can you say a little bit more about how municipal forests are helping to achieve Freiburg's net zero targets, but also to restore your biodiversity as well?
Yes. Yes, I'm a forester and I really love the forest, but going to the city administration meant I didn't have to leave Freiburg. Working with the state administration would have meant that I had to move around the whole country for the next 20 years. So I said, I leave the forest a little bit, but I still have to do with our forest office here in Freiburg. We have a local forest, about 5,000 hectares, lowland forest and up in the Black Forest, that is part of our city territory, up to 1,200 meters. And we really try to manage it, or we manage it on a ecological basis. That means already since the mid-90s, we are have the certificate by the FSC, Forestry Stewardship Council. That means we don't do a huge clear cutting. We don't use pesticides. We limited the not indigenous species to a certain percentage, and we try to combine the social benefits, like that we naturally also forestry people can go hiking or mountain biking and doing sports or just for recreation. We also value the social function of the forest, but we want to produce timber. We produce some 35,000 cubic meters every year on a sustained yield basis, and this is also revenue, but naturally the forest as a whole doesn't make profit because the ecological function or the ecological benefits and the social benefits, they also, the infrastructure is costly for these things. But some money comes in for timber also, and we really try to value this. Sustainability has a long tradition in forestry since 200 years. It was fixed by law that the forest is managed on a sustained yield basis, and it's also a carbon sink. That means not only it's we try to push building and construction by promote building and construction by with timber. We have a small subsidy program that house owners or investors here in Freiburg can get funding from the administration if they make innovative housing projects with timber or with a certain percentage of timber. Sometimes you have to combine the materials also. And we make a balance for the forest, how much carbon is stored in the standing stock of trees, but also how much carbon is substituted. Because if I build with timber, I don't use steel or glass or concrete, especially concrete, which has a huge, huge gray energy backpack, we call it. This is concrete is really Portland cement, especially is really a problem in building. Much worse than bricks, for instance. And we also say it's a temporary sink because, for instance, our old cathedral in the inner part of the city, it's an old cathedral from the Middle Ages. There are fir logs inside that store the CO2 for 800 years already. Yeah? That miraculously survived the Second World War. So the CO2 from the Middle Ages is still stored in this timber. So we think pellets and burning biomass, it's not the first choice. We have to put as much because everybody talking about sequestration and getting the CO2 from the atmosphere, but the only working mechanism we have is what nature invented millions of years ago, is the photosynthesis. This is the proven mechanism that works, and we should combine our technology and use as much carbon sinks in timber, substituting other materials and building with timber, not burning timber. And so we have a small part of our huge carbon balance we have for the city, we have for our forest, we had by experts made a carbon balance that balances and counts all these functions the forest had. But we in Germany, we have a big discussion, which is very romantic. I don't know whether Germans are more romantic than Scottish people, but we say, some people say, leave the forest alone, leave them, leave it be. Forestry is violence. The trees, they scream and don't go with a chainsaw or something like this. And we say, no, we have this tradition of sustainability. We have mixed stands. We don't have monocultures. We have this Douglas fir, which comes from the US, which is very valuable and grows a little bit faster than the indigenous species, but we can work the silviculture out in a way that it gets, will be mixed stands with lots of broadleaf trees. Also, we can have a beautiful forest that is a home for many species and produces timber. And timber is a, it's not a solution for climate action, but it can really contribute to this issue. And fortunately, our very critical population still doesn't question forestry here in Freiburg, which is really an asset, because there are other cities where they around the city, they abandon forestry. They just leave the forest be and say, be romantic and go for a hike, and we don't hurt the trees, something like this. But a forest, you don't look at the single tree, you look at the forest as its all, and I think managing it is a wise thing to do.
Harvesting, do you see a role, do you see a role for more sustainable supply chain for wood fuel biomass for heating at all, or is that a diminishing part of the energy mix?
Well, there is a sector also. It's maybe unfair because naturally some enterprises are invested in this technology, and naturally burning biomass is better than burning fossil energy, because the CO2 which is emitted is recent CO2 which has been stored only some years ago. But I think in the long run, with the technology of fuel cells and heat pumps, everything will be renewable electricity, and we should not burn raw material apart from maybe waste material. If you have a sawmill, then you have a certain amount of waste, like pulp, something like this, or a wafer, these things you put in a wafer board. These things, I think you can, but it's better to put them in plywood or in a wafer board than burn it, because burning means releasing the CO2. And the best thing is not releasing any CO2 from photosynthesis, and try to store it in as many intelligent ways as you can. But I know that in the past decades, it was seen differently, and many people invested in a pellet heating system in their home thinking they do something good. And I think it's not good to have a abrupt strategy change. And also, it must be also for those people who concentrate on maybe building pellet heating systems to have a transition process also. You cannot just change direction like this. But strategically, I think we should not burn timber. We have we collect all the organic waste from all our households, put it in a power plant, and produce biogas by that. And we make use of organic waste. But it's burning timber. It's not a strategic option for the future, I think.
Okay. And just finally, can I ask you about the, and it links to the work on forests. I saw that you're doing a lot of work to develop biomes, which I think we would interpret that in English as more nature networks. Have there been particular...
Biomes, excuse me, I didn't get the word. Are we developing biomes? What is this?
Biomes. Well, I suppose we'd call that some nature networks. So, development of restoration of nature on a landscape scale. I wanted to ask what role the municipality had in that, and are there issues around land ownership if you have some landowners that maybe prefer traditional agricultural use of land compared to maybe rewilding or creating new habitats on a much larger scale?
Yeah, I hope I get the word right. We call it biotopes. It's a certain areas in the landscape.
Yeah, that was it.
Biotopes.
Yeah,
biotopes. I'm sorry. I hope I got the question right. We have biotopes in the forest, which is easy because the forest is mostly owned by the city, so the forest office is in charge. So we have a very elaborated system of parts of the forest that are so-called reference areas, where we don't do anything and just watch nature in order to adapt our management system to natural processes under the real-time conditions. And we have forest biotopes, and we also have areas of where we try to leave the old dead trees, because the significant difference between a virgin forest and a managed forest is the amount of dead timber. And it's really very important for lots of plants and animal species. So we have a network all over the forest of dead timber areas and reference areas and biotopes. And the agriculture is more difficult because we don't do the farming ourselves. We rent it to tenants, and to have an impact on the management is not very easy, because the law for good practice in agriculture comes from the federal level or the state level, and it's not so easy to exceed that. So we try to have always a mixed strategy. That means that we want less rent for renting the land if the people switch to ecological production, ecological farming. So we try to give some incentives and financial incentives. We cannot prescribe that as a municipal law, because we have to stick to the state and federal law. But we try to build up incentives for the farmers so that it's worthwhile for them. Also, maybe to do less intensified farming. Leave more spaces for flowers, and it's like for the older insects, we need special areas. So we try to put some incentives, because we cannot make the regulatory framework comes from the state level or the federal level.
Yeah. Okay. Thanks very much. Back to you, convener. Yeah.
Next up, Liam Kerr. Liam, please.
Thank you, convener. Good morning, Franziska. You detailed earlier on, in response to the convener, some well-established energy efficiency subsidy programmes for homeowners. Can you detail how those work? Is it a grant or a loan? What proportion of the work is funded by the subsidy? And our councils have some very severe funding challenges, so from where does the grant or loan come in Freiburg?
Yeah. It's not a loan, it's a grant. And the thing is that we have funding systems from the state level or the federal level, where it's always said, if this measure is being funded by someone else, this doesn't work. But our local funding system can be accumulated. That means if you get funding from the federal or the state level, you can get our grant nevertheless. And it's not much, but sometimes sometimes you have a situation where a little money, some 5,000 euro, already gives the impulse to invest in this, insulating your roofs, having new windows, naturally we try to we have free energy counseling for every citizen, and we try to encourage the house owners to do as much as they can, not only new windows, not only the basement and the roof, but maybe also the facade, which is tricky, it's costly, and you always have to build up the scaffolds. And this is a totally other issue, the craftsmen or craftswomen who do the job. This is a huge challenge we have. But we have grants, and it's not very much money. Sometimes it's 3,000, 5,000, 10,000 euro for, it depends what you want to do. And you apply for that, and the money comes from the municipal budget. So it's really money of the city, which is given away for free, and if people invest in energy saving, so to say. And this goes to the citizens, and last autumn, the municipal council also decided on a so-called climate action offensive. We have 12 million, this is part of my job, we have 12 million of additional budget that should be invested for climate action in the administration, in the housing sector, in the companies, everywhere. And this is, we are in the process of evaluating all the projects that have been, have applied for this funding.
I'm very grateful. So to reflect back, so it's a grant from the city level that yes. pays a proportion, but certainly not all, of the work needed. Yes. On a related note, you have an affordable housing master plan and build yes. ecological and sustainable factors in from the start of your affordable housing. Can you help me understand who funds that affordable house building? Because if we accept that greener materials and greener modifications can be more expensive. What incentives are in place to encourage people to build those modifications? And is it Freiburg who funds those?
No, we don't need to fund those because we have this Kreditanstalt für Wiederbau, the KfW, which is from the state level in Berlin, and it does a lot of funding in the building sector, especially in the past time, new buildings with the new government we have in Berlin now, a new coalition. They also want to put a focus on refurbishment projects. But there's a lot of funding, and we had an expertise done about how much really, if you look a little bit at the life cycle of a new building, how costly it is really to build a reasonable energy standard. And our experts found out that it's not really much more costly. And if you look at the return of investment you get in a city like Freiburg with the prices being so high, it's really affordable also for the investors to build these standards. And we tried to, it's difficult to be on a confrontative course. So we had a round table with all the real estate people here in Freiburg and had an agreement about certain energy standards in the new building sector. And so we think that with the funding that comes from the state level, if we take into consideration that, there is not much more additional costs for a standard that uses up to, I think, 15 to 20 kilowatts hour per square meter and year. So this is we call it our Freiburg efficiency standard, but this is being funded by the KfW from Berlin, from the state level. And with if you count in this funding, the additional costs for a reasonable building standard aren't so high. This is the experience we have made.
Thank you very much. This is extremely helpful. One final thing, Franziska, if I may. Freiburg is almost exactly the same size as my home of Aberdeen. Now, Aberdeen is traditionally one of the lowest funded councils in Scotland, so has to make some very difficult choices about where it will spend its money. Can you help the committee understand how Freiburg is funded and if it has similar funding pressures, how it decides to prioritise green initiatives over perhaps some of the other things that are perhaps as important?
Yeah, Freiburg has always been a poor city. Apart from the Middle Ages, we had a small rich period when there was silver found in the Black Forest close to here. So that was the time when the cathedral was built. But I think the last 200 years, Freiburg has always been a poor city. We don't have also transformation processes like industries going broke and we have to deal with these things. So we never were rich, so we always had to be clever or try to make the utmost from limited financial resources. We have the university, which is an employer, and we have some industry in the biotech sector, and the health sector is important for our economy, but we don't have big industries like Stuttgart, which has the car industry and is really rich. They can make they can really invest money. So Freiburg never had much, but nevertheless, we think that it's also for us, also we do city marketing and being trying to really achieve something on the field of sustainability and climate action is also a marketing thing, because we see that people are very interested here. People move here. Also small startups move here because they think it's a favorable environment. So we think this being sustainable or trying to achieve things has also an economic return of investment, not as big and as high. And actually also we have this new soccer stadium because also our soccer club is very famous in Germany. It's a underdog club, very low funded, but very successful. And also the old stadium had lots of photovoltaic panels. So it's also a kind of the framing you do for your work. And I think trying to achieve sustainability also has an economic benefit for the city, not big, but it is there. And we think we want to ensure the future for our citizens. We don't want to only get tax revenue, but we try to market these things that can be a blueprint for other cities. We tried naturally also to learn from other cities and other initiatives, but we were always forced to prioritize And it's not so that it always goes in the sustainable direction. We also have situations where we say, okay, we have to block this area and the carbon footprint gets higher, but there will be so much tax income from this company, we want it. And we try to encourage companies that fit in this area, life sciences, health sector, sustainability, solar, smart housing. We try to address these companies, come to Freiburg because they fit in our profile. They fit in this idea, and then there are it's like a how do you say? I like the English word. So Wechselwirkung, it would be in German. There are mutual profits for this approach, but there has never been much money. So it's always also a quarreling. Also, climate protection, climate action is not running on itself. We have the theater wants money, the new ice hockey stadium wants money. Everybody needs the resources, and it's not an easy debate in the municipal council.
I'm very grateful. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Liam. Next up is Colette Stevenson. Colette, please.
Thank you, convener, and good morning, Franziska. It's so lovely to hear about Freiburg's approach to an urban sustainable city, and also I understand it's the sunniest place to live in Germany as well, so it sounds like a lovely place to live. I wanted to ask about procurement, and it states in Freiburg's website that the sustainability of municipal properties and procurement has been a key consideration for many years. What changes did you make in your organisation and your working culture to establish a programme of energy efficiency improvements and changes to procurement practices as well?
Well, this is a huge field of action. I have many, many instruments are working in this field of action. We try to procure things which have a certificate. Sometimes there are, it's detailed so that there is in the procurement chain there is no social injustice. There is no child's work somewhere over the place. We try to procure recycled thing rather than new things. Like this, the most popular thing is naturally paper, because still we are online, but we still use lots of paper in the administration. We have not yet let go, and we try to put into consideration how this is produced, how the things are produced, where they come from, and all these social issues also, but also ecological issues, try to encourage recycling. But it comes also to how we use our working space, how efficiently do we use our offices, our public buildings, how that we have bicycles for the people who can, if you go to a meeting to another town hall, then you can use a bicycle that is owned by the city. We have electric cars, e-mobility for also going to and fro. So we try to have an infrastructure for the people that work in the administration that is as sustainable as possible. We have this new town building where I work here. Town hall is climate neutral with a mixed concept of heat pumps and panels, and we try to encourage to all the people who are employed, like not having too much temperature in their room, saving energy, but also shared offices as much as possible. Naturally, you always have to weigh these things with social frame conditions, not putting too much pressure on the people who work here. But I think it's a procurement and minimizing your footprint on this sector is an approach, not with one strategy, but with many smaller strategies that combined in this field, that as an administration, we naturally also have the power of a big consumer, and what we consume has an impact on the production. And we try to use that. We have biological food in the canteens where the people go for lunch as much as possible. We try to say this is we are not 100% vegetarian, but there's always half of it is vegetarian, and the other side is always declared where the meat comes from, that it's not coming from three times around the world. And so we try to, but it's many small fields of action that combine in the footprint we as an administration have on the field of procurement. So we try to combine small measures to a But we could be better. I think we are not 100% yet.
No, thank you. And it's great to hear that. In terms of local supply chains and procurement, do you actually measure in terms of what procure locally? So there's that supply chain visibility there.
This is very difficult indeed. And I can explain it on the example of food. Where do we buy the food for our canteens, not only in the town halls, but also in the schools? And the law in Germany, I don't know how it is in Scotland, but in Germany we have a law that we can, if we ask enterprises to make us an offer for procuring things, we can say we want only biological potatoes. But it's forbidden to say we want only regional potatoes, because this is in against European law, that there should not all the parts of the European Union should have the same possibility to sell their products. So it's at the moment we are still racking our brains how we can put a stress on regional production, because we want to support the farmers in the region, and we would like, because this has transport costs, has a huge CO2 impact on the product. A biological grown carrot that comes from Peru, it's a thing, but it's easy to say, please make us only offers if it's a biological carrot. But it's, at the moment, lawfully, it's not able to say it must come from the region, because this discriminates all the farmers not farming in this region. And at the moment, we try to work out systems like any people who run a canteen or do the catering here for the schools, they must offer, how do you call this? Food education for the kids. They must organize field trips to a farm. And by this, we hope to have the effect that these are products from the region. But it's indirectly, and it's a little bit like a creative outcome, because we cannot say we want to buy only vegetable or potatoes from the region. This is at the moment still discrimination, and the law. And it's maybe also nicely thought, but I think to have regional chains of products, there should be another possibility to organise that.
Okay, that's really interesting. Thanks very much. No further questions, convener.
Thank you, Colette, very much. Next up is Natalie Dawn, who's joining us online. Natalie, over to you, please.
Thank you, convener, and good morning, Francesca. Your evidence so far this morning has been really, really useful and really helpful, so thank you. I want to touch on issues around transport. So it's really impressive that I think it's 79% of all trips are made by bicycle, bus, train or on foot.
80.
Okay, so it's gone up. Wow. So I'm just wondering, can you expand on how Freiburg's coordinated urban development and transport policy was initially developed? And can I ask specifically how you ensured that the required shift away from private transport to eco-mobility was supported and accepted by all your citizens?
Yes, this is really important, because naturally how I organize transport and mobility has a huge impact on the climate balance, but also a huge impact on safety in the city, accidents, and the huge impact on life quality, like noise and also air quality. So how we organize mobility, how we organize traffic has many, many impacts. Naturally, I'm most interested in the energy issues, but and so people are also interested in how we organize mobility. And we have, first of all, after the World War, there was the decision whether we tear away all the tram lines that have been in the ground since before the World War from the 30s. And Freiburg decided, no, we leave this tram line. So we have it's the backbone of our public transport system is the trams or light rail. I don't know what's the right word.
Trams.
Okay, would be okay. Whereas other cities like Strasbourg in France, which has a green mayor now, they have at a very high cost, they had to put the trams in the street, which is a rather big investment. So Freiburg never abandoned the streetcars and the trams. And this is very, very comfortable, because it's a very fast mean. And then they also, we have, if there's a crossroads, the tram has always priority, which means that it's not only ecologically sound, but it's fast and comfortable, because people don't use public transport because they want to save the world, or most of them don't, but because they want to go from A to B fast and comfortable. And so by this organizing priority for trams, that means that from the outskirts of the city, you are faster with a tram inside in the city center than with your car. And this is also something that people can really feel. They can live this experience. This public transport is fast and comfortable. And naturally, we have to combine this inner system of tram lines with buses in the outskirts. And then since the 80s, we have a regional ticket, which had really a huge impact on behavior of commuters also. We have one ticket, and you can use all the transport systems in the two bordering counties and the city. And with one ticket, I can go from up in the Black Forest, where on Sunday I can take my whole family with one ticket, until I go down in the Rhine Valley close to the French border. And this is really very comfortable for people, and it really convinces you also commuters, because in Germany, going with your own car is something like a religion. I think it's like using arms in the US, having your own car and being able to go everywhere is a very difficult issue, which you can see that on the state level, we still don't have a speed limit on the highways, not even the new government with the green minister, but not for traffic. It's psychologically not easy to switch from your own car to other means of transport. And the one thing is, it must be fast and comfortable, and also connections between buses and trams must be thought of intelligently. And we have a huge system of bike lanes, and we are enlarging this for high-speed bike lanes where you can really, and safety is an issue with all this e-bikes booming at the moment. But naturally, it's one thing, it must be fast and comfortable, and then it must be trendy. The framing, the social framing of what kind of traffic mean do you use is very important. So in Freiburg, we succeeded in having a standard symbol is having a trendy bike, a good bike, not your car anymore. There are other countries, or sometimes I have visitors group, and they say if by us only students and poor people go with the bicycle. If you have enough money, you have your car, and the car is a social status. It's sexy. And here in Freiburg, having a fancy bike is sexy so far that there are some criminals are specialized on stealing expensive cars from the basement in certain city areas where they suspect the fancy cars in the basement. So that means that changing behavior is naturally it's your brain that works, but it's your heart that works also. So having you have to frame using different traffic opportunities that you are doing something good, but it's also it gives you a good image of being sustainable, of being future oriented, of being in a way, somebody avant-garde also. So many people, also white-collar workers, they commute with a bike. And many enterprises, they have showers in their office buildings now where you can change your clothes. It's like some people also come running from afar, I don't know. But if you go with your bike, naturally, this has changed a little bit with e-bikes where you don't get so sweaty. But normally you have also many offices count on people coming commuting with a bicycle and offer the necessary infrastructure for that. So I think it's a mixture of many things, and you need the infrastructure and the comfort, but also you need a story and an image to promote new ways of behavior, because the human being sticks to old things. We don't have a culture of stopping. We don't have a culture of changing things. You have to think out good methods for that.
Absolutely. No, thank you so much for that. I think I agree. When I've been to different countries in Europe, I think the relationship with bikes, it's always amazed me. And having things like that, so that people can have showers and stuff and work, it's just such a different way of thinking. It's definitely the way forward. You actually touched on what my next question was going to move on to, and that was the regional ticketing system. The integrated ticketing system. So I was just wondering if you could tell me any difficulties that were had in terms of getting that up and running. So how successful were you in getting all of the transportation companies to accept the system where just one ticket can be used across all the modes of public transport? And are the transport operators publicly owned or are they private? If you could just expand a little on that, please.
Yeah, they're mostly publicly owned by the counties or by the city. Naturally, it's heavily subsidized also as a transport. You never earn money with that. But the passenger numbers go up and up. It's publicly owned, so we have to to negotiate with the bordering counties and find this common platform of this one regional ticket. But I think everybody found that they profit from it, also the counties, because also they have less problems with traffic jam and parking places when people move to and fro with public transport. So, but it was not so difficult. And I must say that how the money is divided, that this regional pass at the moment still costs something. At the moment, in the whole of Germany, we have this incentive by the new government that for €9 a month, you can go everywhere in Germany with public transport. You can go with slow running trains from here to Berlin for €9 a month. It's an experiment for 3 months. So this is a layer that goes over our regional ticket right now. But normally, I think the revenue from this ticket is being divided between in a ratio that is to the investment for the infrastructure, because naturally we as a city in the middle of these two counties have to invest more in traffic infrastructure than the counties. They mostly have buses, they don't have light rail or trams. So I think the money is divided proportionally, the income from the ticket. And we have a committee that meets regularly and discusses which lines should be enlarged, where maybe we plan putting the tram lines also a little bit in the countryside, over the city boundaries, so to say, in order to get more people on there. And there's a special committee that meets every 3 or 2 months, and where all these strategic questions are discussed. Investing in traffic, especially in tram infrastructure, is very, very costly. Buses, not as much. With buses, we are now in this fuel transformation process. Could it be hydrogen buses, which I would not say, but maybe e-buses, and how we get enough renewable energies, because we don't want e-buses from nuclear power or from natural gas burning. So all these things are also taken into consideration. And naturally, it's might not be forgotten, is that we also want to be a city for pedestrians. We don't want, especially with the demographic development, many people like me getting older and older, we also want to be a city of short ways where you don't have to have a car or don't have to go always with a tram to do your shopping, especially your grocery shopping. So we should not neglect pedestrians. You want a city where the public space has a quality that you want to go there, to walk there. It's not like your path for a pedestrian is like this and the cars go roaring by or the speed bikes go roaring by. We have, but I think all over the place, a growing conflict also between pedestrians and people going with these small electric scooters or with bikes. We have to say a city is a place where people live, and it must be wonderful and comfortable to go by foot. Also, if we talk about health issues, naturally, walking by foot is the basic mobility in a city, and it should be comfortable and safe. And so we are also proud that from the 80s to the 90s, the percentage in the modal split of pedestrians really declined, but now it has gone up a little bit again. And this is also one goal in city planning, that it's a city where you can walk around and you like to walk around. So apart from all this moving quick from here to there.
All right. Thank you so much for your answers there. I have no further questions, convener.
Thank you very much, Natalie. Our final question is coming from Monica Lennon, who's joining us online. Monica, please.
Thank you, convener. Good morning, Franziska. It's been a real pleasure to hear your contribution today. So thank you. And perhaps the committee could come for a visit at some time in the future. In our inquiry into local government, we've heard a lot of complaints about how slow it can be when councils make decisions, in particular around the planning process. So really interested to hear that in Freiburg, your city planning office is seen as a think tank and agenda setter. Could you tell us a bit more about that? And how do you ensure in the municipality that work is widely recognised and is appreciated, and that the staff feel motivated? Clearly, you feel very proud of the work that you're doing. Is that a feeling that the staff also share, and do people want to work in the municipality?
Who wants to work in the municipality is a very important and difficult question because we are competing with many other employers. But I think the planning office is very important, and it's crucial for a city to become sustainable, because it's not only building houses and saying the street go the cars go there and there, but it's really safeguarding life quality and enabling all the other fields of action. Like in the planning process, we must look where do we need solar panels? Do we need to have a district heating infrastructure? Do we need a little piece of ground for an energy central for a hydrolysis for a green hydrogen, for instance? So the planning office, naturally, it looks, it also has the ambition that the city is architecturally beautiful and there's enough innovation and spectacular buildings, but it's enabling a sustainable city because it can ensure the infrastructure that is necessary and combine it with a sustainable buildings, but without neglecting the cultural heritage, without neglecting also these aesthetical point of views. But it's not easy. We have lots of discussions. We, for example, have lots of discussions about green roofs for adaptation and solar panels we need for climate change. So it's always a process of weighing the different issues, and the art is finding a good compromise, finding a good thing. And the planning office has to, it's like playing with all these different things and putting together like a mosaic that in the end results. But I think the planning office is very, very important. And because you cannot say we do this at any cost or we just neglect how a house looks like. And this is a challenge also for the architects, for instance, to build energy sufficient or energy efficient houses. But sometimes they say, oh, the windows are so small and the walls are so thick and it's not beautiful architecture. But I think it's a challenge in for creativity. And I think this also leads to a new self-confidence in the planning department, because they say, without us, a sustainable city will not work. We enable this infrastructure, and we safeguard also the cultural heritage, which in a medieval city is very important. And we work creatively in combining these issues. But it's also, this is not running by itself. It needs a lot of discussion, a lot of exchange, a lot of information. And but I think in the end, this challenge is being taken, especially by the people also here at Freiburg in this office.
Thank you very much. I know we don't have a lot of time, convener, so I'll pass back to you, but it would be interesting to hear from Freiburg in the future about the planning workforce, because we have questions in Scotland. We've seen a reduction in our planning workforce. It would be interesting to see some comparison. But in the interest of time, I'll pass back to you, convener.
Thank you very much, Monica. Yes, we are tight for time, but I would like to ask Franziska a very specific and brief question about how Freiburg's climate plans are financed. Do you benefit from multi-year financing in the sense that you know what your financing from central government is going to be over a 3 or 5 year period, or is the finance set on an annual basis so that you don't have a lot of visibility?
Unfortunately, climate action is still not yet a duty for the. We have in Germany, we have a law that obliges the local authorities to do some things. And then we have the sector of voluntary things. And it's strange enough, climate action is still on the voluntary side. That means the cities are not obliged to do climate action. But so that we don't get a regular funding for that. There are some funding programs by the state level or the federal level. And but we have to apply for that always. We have to apply for that. And so we had to finance our efforts on the field of climate action always mostly from our own budget, which is then competing with other issues. So it's I think there the federal, especially the state level, should do more. We have a climate protection law now in our state, Baden-Württemberg, which obliges people to have, we have a obligation. It's mandatory to have solar panels on any new buildings from June of this year, and next year also if you retrofit your roof. But only now in 2022 comes this duty to have a solar panel. It could have been much earlier. So the We would like to have, as a local authority, a little bit more support from the legislative level, to have more more funding, but also more from the law, more possibilities to push things faster ahead. So there's no regular funding. We have to apply for programs, and most funding comes from the city budget and must be shifted from one field of action to climate action. So this is not an easy debate either.
Yes, I completely understand. That's a similar issue I think we're facing in Scotland, that visibility of funding. But Francesca, that brings us to the end of our allocated time. Thank you very much for your insights this morning, which have been extremely valuable. I hope you have enjoyed meeting with the committee. It would be great to keep in touch going forward. We will make sure we send you a copy of our report in this area when it's published later this year. And it's been fantastic to hear your contributions this morning. So thank you once again.
Thank you, and all the best and good luck for your efforts about climate action. So we are all together in this.
Absolutely. Thank you. Have a good day. Thank you very much.
Yeah, have a good day. Bye.
Bye-bye. That concludes our public meeting, and we will now move into private session. Thank you.